like to thank the sponsors for tonight's forum, the Dahlberg for Senate campaign, Rhonda Sivaraja for Congress. If your name is Rhonda Sivaraja and you're here, stand up and give a wave.
Hey, Rhonda!
Steve Abeler for U.S. Senate. David Carlson campaign, the Emmer campaign. Is Tom here? I did see Tom earlier. I don't see big white hair anymore. The McFadden campaign and the Ortman campaign. So thank you very much for the sponsors.
We very much want to thank the organizers of this event, House District 38A&B, the chairs of those districts respectively and respectfully. The chairs, Kelly Gunderson and Jim John Mullen.
Since I'm so comfortable with it. Thank you everybody for coming. It's on a really cold night, and after a great Wild game last night, I really appreciate, on behalf of Jim and I, appreciate you coming out tonight to listen to the candidates, help put them through their paces, and to help you make a decision. So I wanted to thank you all for coming tonight. I wanted to thank those who were involved in organizing this. I'd like to thank my fellow co-chair, Jim, and I'd like to thank number of people. Lisa, Corey, Josh, Kim, and Bob, and Steve, and Paul, and let's see, did I miss anybody? Three from your side? Christy, Corey. So thank you. This was a really fun experience. All of us, I think, were new at this, and over the last 2 months, we really created a good relationship between the two House districts, and we had a lot of fun putting this together. So thank you for everybody who put time into this. It was a big sacrifice, and I think we did a great job. I'd like to thank Jack and Ben for being here with us tonight, even though we're only even though you're on the air tomorrow morning.
Yeah,
it's nice of them to be here tonight. So thanks, guys. I really appreciate it. And then I'd like to thank the staff at Jimmy's. Wonderful to work with. Cindy, the organizer. Andy, the bartender. Taylor is also here. Yvonne. You guys are excellent. Highly recommended. You guys did a great job helping us get together tonight. So thank you very much.
Great.
And Jim doesn't want the mic.
I'd like to thank Kelly. Kelly did a great job.
Jack and Ben at MC tonight. They'll let you know what we're doing tonight. And be prepared for an 8 o'clock intermission at the bar. We'll see you over there too. Thank you.
I could use this. Can you hear me?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good evening, Twin Cities. Up and at 'em. I'm Jack Tomczak. That's Ben Cruising.
Good evening.
Here's how it's going to work tonight. The opening statements from each candidate, 3 minutes apiece. Then Ben and I will ask each candidate one question. There are a total of four questions, and there is a time for a 2-minute answer, no rebuttals. Then a 10-minute intermission, go to the bar. When we come back, the lightning round, we'll have questions submitted from the evening tonight. We ask one candidate, one question, anyone can rebut. 1 minute to answer the question, 1 minute to rebut. Rebuttal only if the answer is different than the response from the first candidate that answered the question. And then closing statements, which will be 3 minutes apiece.
You said rebuttal a lot.
This is the third time I've moderated a statewide candidate forum, and the first two times I forgot to let the candidates give their opening statements. So it's a big first for me to say you now have 3 minutes apiece for your opening statements. We'll start with Jim Abeler.
Well, thank you, and I appreciate staying so late to keep us going tonight. Who knows who's in the envelope here? How many of you heard that? Thank you very much. Let's give a round of applause to my granddaughter, Rena, please. Thank you very much. Well, she loves to travel. And we've been to 345 places. Yeah, this is my granddaughter, Rena. You didn't know her before. And we were so excited. There you go. Ooh, it's awesome. And she's an incredible granddaughter. And she travels real well, so that's kind of cool. So, she was born a year ago on New Year's Day. We were so excited. But she was born with a massive amount of debt and lost liberties and freedoms she never even knew she had. She started to chat now, and her first words were, "Where was that?" It's Brandon. To protect her from the perils that she's been suffering. And she's actually a metaphor for her whole generation, which is absolutely in peril, as are all of you and the progeny hopefully behind. And so, anybody here going to vote for Al Franken? No? Okay. I won't burden you with, why we think that he's a poor example of a senator. But I looked at what's important to me and why I think I'm the best choice to go represent you in Washington. Many things make you unhappy with the federal government, but four things are going to kill us. The $17 trillion debt and $1 trillion deficit, the whole Obamacare fiasco, the overreach of the federal government where the president thinks he can do anything he wants and all your constitutional liberties are at risk, and finally a federal foreign policy where our friends don't trust us and our enemies don't fear us. The good news is what I can do about that, or the first two in particular, no one else has cut billions of dollars out of the healthcare entitlement part of the budget, which is off limits to everybody. I know how to cut $1 trillion out of the federal deficit over a decade. No one knows how to do that. That will eat our lunch if we don't get our arms around that. And on the whole Obamacare mess, I am the lead, the most knowledgeable person in the legislature on the topic of healthcare, and spend more time reforming and trying to make it work. The whole idea of a mandate we have to buy insurance is just like madness. And we can probably talk more about that. That might be one of the questions, but we'll go on about that. So, but in our grander scheme than all that, what is it America is supposed to be? What was it that drew my ancestors to come here 100 years ago when they were retired, when they were hungry in Ireland and sick of potatoes? And 300 years ago when they came from Germany and Britain and they fought in the Revolutionary War. That's what we're missing. That's what we have to kind of think about. And besides solving the problems, you have to help the dream again. That's what I want to inspire you to, and to send Al Franken back to wherever he would be good at doing. What's he good at? Send them back there. So we'll talk a lot. Thank you very much.
Mr. Dahlberg. Thank you. And again, thanks to 38A and 38B for doing this. I've been working behind the scenes as a Republican activist for many years. I know this is nothing easy to do, to put something like this together, this event. So thank you very much. You know, it's a lot of times that it's events or times that get us involved, and really what got me involved in this race was probably the same thing that's going through your mind. I was looking at what's going on in Washington, D.C., and absolutely shaking my head at the dysfunction that's going out there. And it's getting to be a point where it's like kids in a sandbox. And you know, I'll be an equal opportunity criticizer on this, because I think both parties are guilty of this. They're just kind of pushing it down the field just a little bit off to the side. They're not dealing with this. And so what I looked at is the major issues that we have out that's confronting our society right now. You know, and I have the motivation too. I have a 9-year-old daughter. You look at what is that future going to be for her? And so we have the issue, we have a $17 trillion debt coming down on us. We have the issue of Affordable Care Act, which is taking Obamacare 1/6 of our economy. It's going to eat up. And then we got regulations, which is absolutely killing us. And we have a United States Senator. What is his focus? His focus is fingerprints on an iPhone, or maybe that the IRS should go after private citizen groups. I mean, we need to change this. And so that's what spurred me to run for this. I'm running as a county commissioner all the way up to U.S. Senate. Some people say, wow, that is a huge step. But you know what? I think it's actually a logical step. Because the problem we have is too many times, sometimes it's congressmen that are going out there running for U.S. Senate, and they're just about concentrating more of power on Washington, D.C. I'm a constitutional conservative. One of the things I am is a military man. We talk about staying in your lane. And what that means is you have a mission. Don't worry about what the other mission is off to the side. The problem we have with our federal government right now is that too many people are worrying and they're taking the role of the state government. So we have problems that they're getting into healthcare, which is none of the federal government's business. They're getting into education such as Common Core, again, equal opportunity criticizer. So if Obama's wrong on it, so is President Bush on No Child Left Behind. So I stand before you, and I'm enjoying the conversation tonight. I enjoy the opportunity. But I want you to remember this. In this race, I am a solid conservative that's electable in this race. And twice I've been at the top of the polls up against Al Franken. And I'm looking and I'm working hard to win your endorsement in Rochester, and I'm abiding by the endorsement because I honor the time that you're spending as activists in this. Thank you.
Good evening. to an election in November. And we are so close to defeating Al Franken. But more importantly, we are so close to taking back a majority in the United States Senate. Just think what will happen if Minnesota leads the nation and elects a conservative to the United States Senate. We can say no to the President Obama liberal government agenda. We can say no to the Affordable Care Act. We can repeal Obamacare and never replace it with another federal government program. We can insist on constitutional order. We can have a United States Senate that will stand up to the President of the United States against all those illegal executive orders. Each one another giant step towards tyranny in our country. We need a United States Senator with the courage of her convictions, who will stand up for the Constitution, who will make sure that the Fourth Amendment means something, that the NSA isn't encouraged and funded to spy on innocent Americans. We need to make sure our United States Senate says no to any restrictions on our Second Amendment gun rights. We need to make sure that the United States Senate is the first one to stand up to protect our constitutional rights and to actually be concerned about Minnesotans' best interests and not Carrie Reed's best interests. We don't need a U.S. Senator that cares what Dianne Feinstein thinks or what President Obama thinks. We need a U.S. Senator that cares what you and I think. What's important for our families? What's important for the businesses here? What's it going to take for us to succeed? We have Minnesotans that are struggling to pay for their fuel costs, for their groceries, for tuition, for their health care costs. We have a median income in the United States that has gone down since Obama and Franken were elected from $65,000 to $60,000. We are measurably worse off because of Al Franken. And this time it's not going to be enough to elect just another voter into the United States Senate. This is too urgent a race in the nation. We need to elect a leader for the United States Senate. Someone who will be a voice and an advocate for Minnesota. Who will actually take our concerns and make them the nation's concerns. We can balance the budget deficit in Washington. We can address that $900 billion budget gap. And we can close that gap without raising $1 in taxes. How do I know? Because we did it here in Minnesota. We had a $5 billion deficit when I was chair of the Senate Tax Committee, and we balanced that budget deficit without raising $1 in taxes. We've done it here in Minnesota. We can do it in Washington, D.C. I ask you for your support tonight, but hopefully I hope we'll earn your trust. That's even more important. That's the complete breakdown. Al Franken has destroyed whatever trust we had with our elected officials in Washington. And now it's time to elect a candidate who will work hard to earn it back. Thank you all very much for being here.
Good evening, thanks for coming. The thing I want to talk about first is electability. Some of you are on a side that most Minnesotans aren't. And the thing we have to remember is we are united in one area, and that is defeating Al Franken. So how do we do it? Well, we're going to have someone who has some issues that are popular with Minnesotans. For example, gay marriage. Every single person up here opposes gay marriage. I'm the one candidate who was on the side with the majority of Minnesotans. That's a big issue because it's not necessarily about who all of you want. It's about who do all of our neighbors want. Because, again, the biggest thing we want is to get rid of Al Franken. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself and my background. I'm from East St. Paul. I started watching politics at age 10. My mom's back there, she can tell you. I was watching Meet the Press, something was obviously wrong. I was watching CNN instead of cartoons. So eventually I went to Johnson High School. My first job in politics, I was an intern for Governor Ventura. One of the most interesting experiences, I have to say. But I learned quite a bit. I worked for Secretary of State Kiffmeyer in the Business Services Division. Learned a lot about business. I talked to business owners every day. That was my sophomore year of college. Eventually I went up where Mr. Dahlberg's from. I went up to Duluth, to the University of Minnesota Duluth, studied political science. I decided it was really cold, and I wanted to go where it was really rainy, so I went to England. And went and studied in Lancaster University, I studied foreign policy. So I came back as I was in the Marine Corps officer program, and the war in Iraq started, and my friend said I was gonna miss the entire war. So I left college, enlisted in the Marine Corps infantry, and I served 3 combat tours as a machine gunner. So I was in Fallujah, Battle of Fallujah, the Battle of Ramadi. Once I got out, I had 2 daughters. They're 7 years old, so I do have an interest in what happens in the future with my kids. In addition to myself, I'm 32. So when I got out of transfer to the University of Minnesota, I graduated with a Bachelor's of Political Science.
I have a master's from the University of Minnesota in Security Strategies and Technologies. Basically, critical infrastructure protection, foreign policy, national security. I went to Florida State College of Business. I got a graduate certificate in entrepreneurialism. I started my own business. That's one of the reasons I'm running, is the reason why this economy is not doing very well is because there's no access for people like me that are trying to start a business. Finally, I go to Texas A&M University right now. I go to the Bush School of Government. I study advanced international relations and intelligence and homeland security and U.S. border security. What I do with the rest of my time, when I'm not doing all that, I teach at St. Paul, I teach high school. So again, the biggest thing I think to impress on all of you is we want to win. We don't want Al Franken. That's the one thing we agree on. We disagree on certain issues, but there's one thing we can agree on. And in my opinion, if any of the other candidates up here get elected and they win the primary, it's a guaranteed Al Franken victory. And that's 6 more years of Al Franken. So I think we need to look at who's electable and who can win. And that's really the biggest question I think all of you and the rest of Minnesota will have. Thank you.
Good evening, Republican leaders. Welcome to the forum tonight. Thanks for putting on. Gentlemen, thank you for emceeing it. My name is Monti Moreno, and hold the microphone up. I've been a small business owner for about 25 years. I live in Marina on St. Croix with my lovely wife, Nancy, and our 4 children. I'm a farmer, small business owner. And when I look at what has happened to our country, it has been absolutely decimated by this current administration in Washington and what's going on in St. Paul. Now I'm going to be coming in a full circle back to something I want to talk about, but I am a constitutional conservative and I am a Reagan Republican. Ronald Reagan was one that won me to the Republican Party. I grew up in the inner city of St. Paul between the McDonough Projects and the Mount Dairy Projects and arguably the poorest neighborhood in St. Paul. Out of the poorest neighborhood, we are the poorest family. Out of the poorest family, I was like the youngest. It was like getting it, man, bottom of the barrel, right? So I was 7 out of 8. So we had 2-bedroom, 1 bath, no shower. And grew up street fighting. And our house burned down when I was 10. My parents were divorced. And I moved out here to White Bear Lake, Minnesota, just a few miles from here. Graduated from White Bear High School. Now, I started boxing. And then I became a gold glove boxer and became a gold glove boxing champion. Started the White Bear Boxing Club that's still in existence and run by one of my neighbors today, Gary Struss. But it didn't start that way, okay? I grew up in the inner city. I now live in former Governor Al Cleese home up in Marina on St. Croix. There's always been a thing called upward mobility, where you'd be able to go from the lower class to the middle class to the upper class if that's what you choose to do. And that's been taken away and everything's being reversed right now. People are going from the upper class to the lower class and middle class to the lower class. Our food stamp rates have gone from 25 million to 50 million. It is up 100%. Jobs are down. Everybody understands the problem. I understand where you're at because I'm there right with you. And I'm basically sick and tired of being sick and tired of what I see going on in Washington. But let me talk about one thing that nobody up here has talked about. It's the elephant in the room, and it's race. If you look at my last name, it's Moreno. I grew up on the West Side. The first boxing club I fought for was a Mexican-American boxing club. We have a lot of illegals in Minnesota. And Mark Payton in this last session passed a bill that allowed the voter to motor bill, right, you're familiar with it, for all the illegals now to get driver's licenses, and as soon as they do, now they have the right to vote. You understand that? What are we gonna do as Republicans to bring them over? 70% of the population right now is these illegals. In 2 years, it's going to be 9%, and in 5 years, it's projected to be 11%. Either we're going to be a permanent minority, the way it is run right now in St. Paul, and if that's the case, we better get used to it. If these people are going to vote, we need to bring them to the Republican Party. My name is Monti Moreno. I will help bring them over and bring Minnesota to a majority to the Republican Party because the Latinos have more in common with the Republican Party, God-fearing people, hard-working people, more than they do with the Democrats who want to make them and put them on public assistance. Thank you so much.
Steve McKee, the mic, we'll start with you. I'd like to say that Mike McFadden tried to be here tonight, but schedule's conflicted. And Philip Parrish is also running for Senate.
We're now to the
questions portion of the debate. Forum. It'll be four questions, 2 minutes for all of you. You'll all get a chance to answer, so no rebuttals. We'll begin with Monti Moreno. The first question, are there any laws you would work to repeal besides Obamacare, and why?
Is there any laws I'd work to repeal? The first thing I would do, ladies and gentlemen, is being your next U.S. Senator going to Washington, is I would be believing that the United States Senate would now be controlled by the Republicans. The House of Representatives would be controlled by the Republicans, and the first thing I would oversee would be the impeachment of Barack Hussein Obama. You get rid of Barack Obama, and all of a sudden Obamacare and this whole tirade of a nightmare of a mess goes away. I don't know about you, but for starters, the first thing I would push back on isn't a law, but it would be the EPA. The Environmental Protection Agency has done more to hamper any growth or recovery in America than any other institution by a bunch of, I'll be nice, a bunch of appointed bureaucrats. These people have stopped in its tracks, along with people like Al Franken, the Keystone XL pipeline, which would create 140,000 jobs. The Gulf of Mexico, there was an explosion down there. 44,000 people lost their jobs. The courts ruled it was an accident. The government stepped in and said, you know what? You're not going back to work. These 44,000 people are filing bankruptcy. Their homes are in foreclosure, and their lives are destroyed. And you've seen the EPA step in every way, shape and form, shutting down industry after industry after industry, from the coal industry, the war on coal. Who has seen their energy prices rise? Raise a hand. Pretty much everybody. That's because of the war on coal. Now what's happening, then they shut down the smelting plant, the only smelting plant, the Dahlberg plant. Only plant in North America. 11% of the world's lead supply is now shut down. How many of you came here tonight by a car? How many of you have a battery in that car? Your battery prices are ready to go up because it's not being made here. Bullets are not being made here now. The biggest pushback I would go is the EPA, and it would push back on every industry. Thank you very much.
Carlson, are there any laws other than Obamacare that you would work to repeal, and why?
I think the biggest thing we have to do is increase access. And we kind of play off of what Monti Moreno said. I think energy is the one area where you can give a lot of access, a lot of opportunity. If you look, how does Russia became from a desolate superpower that failed to the country that's invading all around Eastern Europe? Energy. They supply most of Europe with their energy. So I think we do need to expand and open up areas for drilling, whether it be oil, whether we need to get coal, natural gas. But I also want to increase penalties, because I also like clean water. And when you look at what happened in the BP oil spill, you had a company, Transocean, that did not shut down a drill that they needed to repair. Nobody did any time for it, and there's a small fine. So what ends up happening? We don't drill anywhere. So we have all this oil under the ground, and it's not being taken out. So I think we have to open up for opportunity and for jobs. Second of all, we need to increase penalties. And if people aren't doing the right thing, they should pay for it. We shouldn't pay for it, people shouldn't pay for it. We should have to do that. And secondly, I would say opportunity with business loans. I think as a small business owner, I've had so much trouble trying to get a business loan. And I qualify for a ton of veteran loans from the Department of VA, SBA. And I can't get anything because I don't have any collateral. But I could create a lot of jobs. So we can get $550 million to a solar company that loses their money in a year, no one goes to prison, no one goes to jail, yet all these companies can't get any cash. So I think the cronyism, which Sarah Palin, who Julianne Ortman is now endorsed by, Sarah Palin uses the term cronyism. I think there is cronyism. And what needs to happen is people like myself and other entrepreneurs need to be able to be given the tools to start a business and actually create jobs. And we need to go on the offensive in this economy, not just sit and play defense and cut and look for ways out of the problems. We actually need to start making money and start getting business back again. Thank you.
Question again, are there any laws that you would work to repeal besides Obamacare, and why?
Well, our executive branch agencies are authorized by Congress to pass all the rules and regulations and all of the mandates via what's called a delegation of authority. So back in 1990, Congress authorized the 1990 Clean Air Act. and the EPA has been passing rules and regulations and adopting them that have really been hurting our economy as well as our businesses and job environment because of these rules and regulations. I think it's incumbent on our U.S. Senate, when we take back the Republican majority, to repeal all of those delegations of authority and begin again. I, for one, am tired of hearing congressmen and women saying they don't have any real authority when it comes to those agencies and all the rules and regulations. They have to be our spokespersons in Washington. They are the ones that can repeal those delegations of authority. So let me give you a good example. Just recently, the Minnesota Cohasset Power Company spent $380 million to upgrade in order to eliminate mercury emissions. Well, that's great, but all the ratepayers ended up paying more for the costs of the upgrade, right? But that recent upgrade didn't include the carbon emission standards that are going to be imposed in 2015 by that same agency. And now Cohasset Power and all the other agencies in the state of Minnesota are going to have to upgrade again. And those costs are going to be passed along to the ratepayers. Congress has a very important role, not just in oversight, but in the confirmation of all of the secretaries and undersecretaries and deputies, and they need to be more aggressive. They need to repeal those delegations of authority. My first bill will be to put a moratorium on all new rules and regulations other than emergencies, so that we stop with the pages and hundreds of pages every hour of new rules and regulations that are choking our economy, our businesses, and our family with new mandates and new rules and new requirements. There is work to be done. Our U.S. Senate should be entrusted with that very important responsibility, and we shouldn't take no for an answer.
As I mentioned, and I think it would be a lofty goal, in the 6 years that I would be a U.S. Senator, I would have three objectives. It's addressing the $17 trillion debt, absolute repeal of Obamacare, returning it back to the states, and it's the issue of government regulations, which is absolutely killing American jobs. And so that's the third one is the area that I would work on, is addressing the regulations that are killing jobs across this country. You know, the military sent me out to the Presidio to learn Mandarin Chinese because they thought in this global environment, they might need a military officer that would know Mandarin Chinese. Well, at the rate that our country is going because of elected officials such as President Obama and also because of issues like Senator Franken, we're going to actually need Chinese, all of us, because we're going to be working for the Chinese. It's absolutely ridiculous. We are letting elected officials in Washington, D.C. let other countries hand us our lunch on the global playing field. So that's one of the areas we absolutely can work on, is changing the laws for regulation. You know, up in my area, we have a thing called polymath we're trying to get going up there. These are not, you talk about minimum wage jobs, these are getting, and I call them kids because I'm 52 years old, but 28, 30-year-old young people having jobs, $50,000, $60,000 a year. Now that's a real job. But you know, to get a new mining permit on the Iron Range, it's actually taken longer than the time it took when Kennedy decided to get a man to the moon and actually executed it. That is absolutely outrageous. To me, it's absolutely a crime what's going on in our country. And that's the one area that I would address. The other one is we could do a liquid petroleum gas exportation that we could work on. And one of the things is the process is so complicated right now that certain countries that have free trade agreements, there's kind of a fast track there. So that's an area that we could work on. That's going to create new jobs there. The other one is Keystone XL. We have to work on the government regulations on that. It's ridiculous, again, that right now how many wrongs have we had on this again. And we need to get this going. And I've confronted Senator Franken head on, because all he's given is lip service on this subject. Thank you.
Well, thank you. There's all kinds of things we wish we could do. And everybody's given a list of what they wish they could do. In the human service world, in 16 years in the Minnesota House, I actually have changed how we do our human services work. And we've made a difference. We've gotten DHS to repeal a lot of the regulations and made streamline how healthcare can work. That's how we did the $1 billion reductions without hurting anybody, and it didn't even show up in the elections. What the peril is now is that there's so many federal regs on the human service part that we are hamstrung from our reforms. I actually could get some of those changed. That's my head of expertise. I know how to work with people to actually get those done. And I made a list of other things that we should work on. This whole education thing, no child left behind. Education is not a federal task, it's a state task. Everything they've done in Washington for education has hampered Minnesota. And also in the healthcare part, which is also a state task. This whole Patriot Act and NDAA, where you can be arrested as a regular citizen, really? The Fourth Amendment shall not be violated. You feel that's my favorite part of that amendment. Look it up, it's awesome. We're free until we pass all these laws. You gotta repeal those. I live by the train tracks in Anoka. The trains come by, 65 trains, city trains a day, full of black oil cars coming from the Bakken, all on private land. Celebrate that we now import less than half of our oil. But no thanks to the president and the federal government. Those are all on private lands. We have to open up the federal lands that are up there as well and even make the boom bigger. And finally, the last thing, since I'm out of time, the IRS has this law about civil seizures. There's a person in the paper today. They have a gas station, they bring, or a little store, they bring in cash. It's kind of close to the number. And so they seized, I think, $35,000 from this little gas station in America. Sorry, I'm out of time. Thank you.
David, you're first on this next round. David Carlson. We'll keep heading in the same direction. All right, David, what system do you prefer to elect presidents? National popular vote or the Electoral College, and why? So, one of the things that you'd have as a problem if you went to national popular vote is you have, as we saw in the Coleman race, sometimes votes get found in freezers, sometimes votes get found in back cars, and sometimes votes just get found who knows where. So national popular vote brings a lot of votes out of the city, areas that aren't really that strong for Republicans. You take that and juxtapose it with the Electoral College, states like Idaho have a say. Because even if they have 4, 5, 10 electoral votes, it's still 10 votes. And if you need 10 to win president, that's important. So I think if I had to say, I keep the Electoral College, because it does give every state some kind of a voice. Because if we go into a national popular vote, I'm afraid that it will entice greater voter fraud, and we weren't able to get voter ID passed in Minnesota. And I think that's a problem, because most people support voter ID. So I think Electoral College is probably the best way to go. I don't think changing to a popular vote would do anyone any good. Thanks.
What system do you prefer to elect presidents, national popular vote, or the Electoral College, and why?
Well, I support the Electoral College. I don't support the national popular vote. In very close races, it does make a difference. And I don't think that there should be so much emphasis from in our elections from California and New York and Florida and Texas, the very highly populated states. It's good that Minnesota does have electoral votes. And I think that in those very close races, it does make a difference.
Absolutely, unequivocally, the Electoral College. And to me, it's about states' rights. And the whole issue, as I've been talking about, is I want to have more control on the states. If we go the other way, it's all going to be done at the end of the day. It's going to be about California and about New York deciding what's going to happen in this country. One of the things that I've been talking about is, you know, the system is just set up for failure the way we have it right now, is that we send $10 out to Washington, D.C. They're the middleman out there. They take $3, they send us back $7. Well, that's a nice system when you got California, you got New York controlling this. And that's the way they'd love this direction to go, because for them all in Minnesota and all this area, all this to them is flyby territory. And that's why we gotta stand up to it. What's really saddens me is you have Senator Franken out there. And you look at some of the decisions he's had. I mean, he does not understand that he's representing Minnesota. He's not representing New York, he's not representing California. So you have the issue like the medical device industry. And here he's going right with them in the sense that this is an important thing for our area, for our jobs, and he's not representing us locally. But it would be the Electoral College.
Do you have the question again, Representative Abeler? I would like to. That's right, good money. What system do you prefer to elect presidents? National popular vote or the Electoral College, and why?
It's just good to get the question from a real professional.
Thank you, Jim.
Actually, we've spent a lot of time talking about this topic the last couple of days. And it's not as simple as it thinks, and as you might think. And so each side has strengths. One of the beauties of being in office is you get to have a position, then you learn, and you might change your position. I actually voted for the National Popular Vote last year. I no longer would vote the same way, or today I would vote no. I'm persuaded the opposite way. In 1972, I believe, was the last time Minnesota went for a Republican. That was Richard Nixon. And then Watergate happened as this 18-year-old person, and it was very disconcerting to me. And so we all voted, if you voted Republican, and it didn't make any difference. So I'm thinking, there's got to be a way to make a difference. And so the allure of national popular vote is, well, they'll come and they'll, all the votes matter. Your vote will matter, and you can add up all yours, and if there's enough, then Romney would have won, which would have been kind of sweet, compared to what we got. And so, but the peril about that is that California, what was it, 3 million extra votes? Between the winner and the loser in California is 3 million votes, which would marginalize, I think, 10 states who are with closer than that, the small states, as people have mentioned. And so it's an illusion and an oasis that I think just isn't ready for prime time. What I would hope to do is that if we could get our electoral votes apportioned by a congressional district, that would make some sense. Because then it would make sense if you live in my district, we actually get to get our one vote going for President Romney or for the rest. And while I just mentioned I changed my mind on a vote, when this election happens, we're going to have quite a process. And in many seats, I'll be contested endorsements and all that. We have to hang together and help us all learn by being smarter. We all can be educated, we get enlightened, and that's how you get the best legislators, the best government.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, how many of you have seen a map of America right after an election? Almost the entire center of the country is red, and we have the two coasts are blue. I've got the solution. The West Coast falls into the ocean, and everything's red. But I am for the Electoral College. When I look at that, what it does, it gives each state a voice and allows the people to be heard across America. I am for stopping the fraud, however, and we all know that there's nothing but fraud everywhere. 35,000 votes in North Carolina, 40,000 in Tennessee, of votes of people have never existed. I remember, I think, when Tom Member was found 10,000 votes in the Trump, right? Somebody found 10,000 votes, and guess what? You know, we have a Democrat in the governor's office now. So I'm for, my wife and I some years ago went to a place called Disneyland. Anybody ever heard of it? Actually, it was Disney World, it's Florida. And we were standing in line, and a gal walked up. We walked through, had to wait to buy our tickets, and we went up, and this gal came up, and there was this round little sphere type thing, and she put her hand on it, and she walked through the gate. I'm like, what the heck is that? And I stopped her and talked to her. And she said, well, what it is, I'm a season ticket holder. And what happens is you come in, you put your fingertips on here, and it reads your fingerprints. She said, I have a twin sister. If she comes down from Ohio, she puts her hand on here, and it wouldn't match, even though we look the same with an ID. So if we use fingerprints, it would be a great way to do it. Right now, the technology is available. It would transfer your fingerprints into a number, and that number is what you would vote by, which would help stop dead people from voting. All right? Thank you.
And so, question three, do you think our immigration system and laws need to change? Why? And what changes would you impose?
Well, first, we need border security, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
We need a secure border. And, you know, our Congress has actually authorized the Department of Homeland Security with funding and asked them to put together an operational border security plan. But they waited, and they waited, and they still haven't produced that operational security plan. And so a strong U.S. Senate with the power of confirmation would never confirm another commissioner or secretary of the Department of Homeland Security until I get the plan, right? And so we need border security. Why? So that we don't have wave after wave of additional illegal immigration. But more importantly, we need to build trust between the folks that live here in the United States and our government. ICE, those rules and laws, immigration and customs enforcement, they need to actually enforce the laws. We've got folks that work in that agency that are suing the federal government because they're confused about whether they're actually supposed to enforce the laws as law enforcement officers or not. So we need some clarity here. We don't need a president that is undermining our laws with the executive orders that we talked about at the very beginning. And as the president continues to grant all these executive orders that undermine our immigration laws, we all have very serious doubts about whether the laws actually mean something or not. So I'm in favor of considering changes to the law, but only first after we've secured the border. And secondly, we have confidence that the laws that we currently have will be enforced, so that when we know that we actually are going to approve a change, that change will mean something and it will be enforced. We have a long way to go to building trust with the administration. And so that's another reason why I think we need a very strong U.S. Senate that will do its job to insist on that operational security border, or operational border security plan, and also to insist no more confirmations until we get it. Thank you.
I'm a fourth generation Minnesotan, fourth generation American, and you can maybe tell sometimes by the accent, but I'm a Finlander, I'm a Swede. And I think legal immigration is, and I say legal again, is absolutely wonderful for this country. It replenishes the American dream. We get people that come to this country that are hungry and thirsty. And so what we need to do, though, is we need to put back integrity into the immigration system. So the first thing I would start with, and I would have opposed the Senate immigration bill, because it links to the issue, and I think it's a pathway, it's an amnesty pathway for illegal immigrants. And first, before we deal with that and the illegal immigrants, we have to secure the border. And I don't want to have the two put together. And here's the reason. And I think probably everybody can understand this, but frankly, I don't trust President Obama. And so the issue is, if we pass a law that links the two together, I can tell you what he's gonna do. He's gonna say, you know that secure fence we're talking about? I'm sorry, it's just causing a little trouble. We can't get to that. But the other issue, boy, we can get the fast track. And isn't it absolutely amazing that they now say, you know, we just don't have enough money to secure this border. It's, you know, it's like getting a man to the moon. It's always a problem with money when it doesn't work on their side. We can absolutely secure this border, right? Yes. And the other thing we can do is let's use smart technology. Let's go where the soft points, where we know that there's melting points in there. And then let's have an intelligent, open, respectful discussion about immigration. Because we're really working on an immigration policy that's not fit for the 21st century. It's really fit for the 18th century. And so when my great-grandparents came over here, really what they were doing is, was almost, when they came to this country, it was almost like checking out a horse to work on a farm. Because they looked at their mouth and their teeth and said, are you healthy? Yeah. Do you really want the American dream? Do you want to come here? Yes. Now I think we need to rethink this, because what type of people do we want to recruit to this? We can have a policy, and we should have an immigration policy that works for this country and that benefits the United States. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me start by reminding us all that even though this immigration issue is a big deal, most of the immigrants in this country are here legally. And they provide an awesome opportunity for America and for our future, and we absolutely need them. Unless you're Native American, you're all immigrants. And just the matter is when you came. And so you don't want to lose that in the middle of all the other discussion. There's three parts I would talk about in general. I would have voted no on the Senate bill, because it just was too much. First, you have to secure the borders. I wish you could have heard that before. See, some of the same ideas are really right. There's something called e-verify. You know what that is? That's where the employer actually has to check against a number base, database to see if you're legal here or not. We should do that. We're supposed to do that. Minnesota doesn't like doing that, but we need to. And then you have to follow the laws. We are a nation of laws. Whatever the president thinks, it's a law. And if you don't like the law, then change the law. We have methods for that. We need to follow the laws. We have some people respect the laws. And when, if, like I was mentioned before, if you want to do a deal with the president on something he's, that he would suggest, how could you trust the guy to keep his word? He undoes any law that he thinks he doesn't like, which is perilous. If you do a contract with a guy who never keeps the contract, why would you do business with the guy? And so we would bargain, negotiate this, some version of the Senate bill or the House bill, and we'd pass it, he would just do the good stuff and leave all the hard things that we thought were reasonable to add into it and not do it. One final thought. With the human services world, where we
I have a lot of the people getting services. The last question, according to federal rule that we're told to ask, is after you do all the income and where you're from, how long you've been here and all that, the last question is, are you a legal immigrant? Really? It's out of control. And so we can make a difference. We gotta stand our ground and actually support the laws that are there. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Monti Moreno, and again, the first thing I would start with is securing the border. Now, when you're looking at immigration and what's happened on our southern border, as Julianne mentioned earlier, the money was allocated years ago. Everything was put in place to secure the border, but it was left unsecured. It was left unsecured by Republicans and Democrats alike. This is not just a Democrat issue. Do you understand that? That's been going on for years. Now, the situation we're running into is this. It's a very simple equation because many issues are connected together. Now, you ask yourself, why would a Republican leave the border open? Good question. And I will contend to you that the reason it's been done is because there's been 53 million abortions in America. You have the baby boom generation, which is approximately 110 million baby boomers, and approximately 10,000 are retiring every single day. Now, there's only 43 million Generation Xers. There's 75 million Generation Y. Generation X and Y together, two generations, are about the same size as the baby boom generation, which I'm a part of, and I believe many of you are as well. So what they need to do is they need to generate money to pay Social Security, to have money in the coffers, to pay for the retirement benefits of the people retiring now. Does that make sense? Does that make sense to anybody? So what's happening is because of social engineering devised by the Democrats, it has thrown our country into a tailspin. And what we're looking at right now is the Democrats, Republicans together put this together, and now we have a bunch of families caught in the midst of it, and now you're gonna tear the families apart and separate them. It is a very large issue, but again, if we don't get those illegals who are here, who now can vote legally with the motor voter bill, we will be the minority for a long time. We need to bring them over. Again, my name is Monti Moreno, I can do it, thank you.
How many people here think we're at war on the southern border by raising your hands? I think we're at war too. One of the things, as I mentioned earlier, I study at Texas A&M University right now, Homeland Security and U.S. Border Security. So I understand it at least a little bit. When you look at the issues on the border, there's a few things we need to start with. One, we have a lot of criminal illegal aliens who aren't being deported anymore. We read that every day. They're gone, without a doubt. Secondly, we have to make a deal. That's just the bottom line. If we say, hey, we're the party, no, we don't trust President Obama. Immigration is a big issue. If he makes a deal and then he wants to go back on it, there's gonna be a lot of people holding him accountable, and you have elections coming up. So I don't think we necessarily have to worry about that. I think there are people who've been here legally and illegally in immigration. The people who've been here illegally and haven't committed crimes other than being here legally. I think there is some room for a path to citizenship for a number of them, but it's been echoed. I want a border wall. I want to increase the border patrol. I want to put drones on the border. I want to get a border protection force. I want to give veteran preference to, you got all these veterans who don't have a job. Let's put them on the border. Tactical units on the border. It is a war. The drug war is reaching Minnesota. We're not immune up here. I just read an article about up in North Dakota, the Bakken fields. They are up there and they're active. And we're making mistakes because we're sitting here and we're dithering, and we're sitting here arguing about who we can believe, who we can't believe. I think we do need to do something about it. And I think, as a senator, I'm gonna say, hey, there's a small group of people who've been here legally, yes. I'm willing to let them have a path to citizenship, pay taxes, and become American citizens. But we need to secure the border, we need to build a wall, not a fence, but a wall, something that is secure and that's gonna keep drug trafficking out, human trafficking out, and something that's gonna keep us safer and give peace of mind on the southern border. And I think that's the main things you can do on the border. Thank you.
All right, the fourth question, the final question for this halftime. Are the Common Core curriculum standards the prescription for fixing the public education system? If not, what are your realistic ideas to improve the education system for all learners? Chris, you're first.
Thank you. They're not the right fix, and they're they're obscene and they're outrageous. I don't know if has anybody seen the books, the curriculum out there? I mean, it's something else. And I have a 9-year-old daughter, and I was out at the 8th Congressional District Convention, and we had a meet and greet the night before Friday night. And we were sitting at the table, and a couple ladies showed me what the course book was. And they're trying to teach it to my daughter at 9 years old. That's what they want to get into the education system. And it was basically pornography about having sex at that age. And I remember being embarrassed when I was a 16-year-old boy in sex education, but never was it this graphic as it is for 9-year-old girls and boys. And so it's outrageous. And this is where I'm getting that local government is the best government. And that's why when I started this, I said, I'm a county commissioner. That's a big step there. But I get it. And the issue is, where does the wisdom of the people come? It comes from right in this room here. And so when local elected officials make what I call a bonehead decision, they're thrown out of office. But what's going on right now in Washington, D.C.? It's because they have so much money, so much special interest money. You got Al Franken getting Hollywood dollars, and then the Republicans do the same thing. They got their power brokers. And so, that's where we're losing the touch with this. And the idea that they go out to Washington, D.C., and once you get out there, it's like Get Smart or something. They got this cone of intelligence they put up over their head, and somehow they've got the one-size-fits-all answer that's going to work for every part across this country. It's crazy. It's a recipe for failure. Our founding fathers, when they put forward this, and I started this, I'm a constitutional conservative, it wasn't by accident that they put the greatest document together ever. And they look back hundreds of years of research, how do you put checks and balances on here? But the best government is local government. So you ask me what the solution is. What as a U.S. Senator, I'm going to say, it's none of our business out there in Washington, D.C. Let the states take care of it. Thank you.
Are the Common Core curriculum standards the prescription for fixing the public education system? If not, what are your realistic ideas to improve the education system for all learners?
That's awesome.
I'll do it every day, Monday through Friday, 6 to 9 a.m. and 11:30.
Anyway, the whole Common Core thing came out of an effort by the National Governors and the National Chamber and some other people who thought they should be able to measure how Minnesota compares to Arkansas. We already know how it compares. We're the best. We're way better than almost all the other states. So don't help us out. Whenever you try to measure and equalize them all, the high ones go down, the bottom ones may not even rise. And so the whole thing is a mess, and it's really a bad, bad thing. The problem is it's gonna be infiltrating into all the states anyway, because the testing is gonna follow this. It's a real problem. And the data is gonna be exported out to private companies so they can sell your kid information on how to be a better math student. Which is why I put a bill into the legislature with my good Senator Arthur Chamberlain to limit the data that can be exported to none outside of the state without parental permission, without even, you can't in the state education department, can't export it at all. And finally, that any changes in curriculum would be approved by our state, at least as a firewall. Couldn't get a hearing. That's how difficult, disappointing it is. The feds have no business doing education, no business. Minnesota's a leader. They should do Minnesota and Tennessee and Mississippi and Arkansas. And we founded a charter school back in 1994, which actually wound up being a lever against the Anoka district to get them to be more friendly to parents, which, by the way, are the primary educator of your children. Not the feds, not the state, not your school district, but you are the primary educator of your children. Just want to tell them, oh yeah, thank you. But to the point now, the Anoka district has the lowest achievement gap. You know what they do with the crazy idea they do there under current law? When you take a test and the kid is low on math, they work on math.
Yeah.
Whoa! And so with the leverage of our charter school and me helping with all the testing we've done to make it practical, Anoka can now brag on being the best in the state. The whole world should follow Anoka school district and fix it. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, I believe I agree with you that Common Core is not the answer. It is not the solution, period. I believe a locally based education system is definitely the better way to go. This is a state-run issue. This should not be coming down from some mandate from some bureaucrat in Washington, D.C., and I hope you agree. When you look at Washington, D.C., when you look how illustrious they are, what a great system they've set up, there is a charter school out there. Anybody familiar with it? There's one really great charter school. It's basically a private school. And you can have up to 300 students. Every year, and you see the same thing in New York, approximately 8,000 students apply for 300 openings. And what I am for, and I always have been for, is a voucher system to allow people to pick up, move out, and go to a school that's going to educate your children the way you want them educated versus having a government education. Because it's really not the schools educating your children. These are government schools. It's government money. And they're government schools, and they're teaching what the government wants your kids to know. And so it's time that the parents have the authority to take things back. When you start looking at private schools, when you compare private schools to public schools, whether Catholic or whatever the case may be, parochial schools, they deal with, you know, reading, writing, arithmetic. And the kids come up with a lot, lot better education than what they have where they can go learn about, the zombie apocalypse in schools you're seeing today. So I am absolutely for privatization, allowing people to be able to take your children and put them in a school that they will get the education that you want and not being dictated to from Washington. Thank you very much.
So as I mentioned earlier, today I was teaching at Central High School. I taught computer science, and tomorrow I teach at Johnson High School, I teach English. So I'm actually in the classroom every single day. And I can tell you the average senator is 65. The average wealth of the senators is 15 million. So we have the richest Senate in history and we have the oldest Senate in history. So we got a generation that, I graduated in 2000 and I barely understand some of these kids. Everything has changed. The entire education system has changed. And we need to look at what is best for these kids and how to prepare them for the future. Minnesota is the best. But we're only as good as our weakest link. If the rest of the country is having problems and they're failing, and Minnesota's doing great, well, what's that do for the United States? So we need standards, and there needs to be measures to say, hey, these guys are doing good, these guys are doing bad, what's not working? Another thing that actually is kind of funny, you guys probably don't think of, these kids are hungry. They barely have any food on their plate. We've taken, through the Obama administration, you get a chicken patty and that's it. Some lettuce and a milk. That's lunch. And these kids are starving. So that's another thing is, let's give them some food. But when you're looking at reforms in education, I think we really need to have some people in the Senate who actually understand what's going on in classrooms. Not people who are talking to superintendents. And you get this anti-bully amendment, everyone up here opposed it. Was it the best amendment ever? Was it the best wording ever? Probably not. But I wanted something to be done because I have kids come crying to me at the end of the day because they're being called fat or you're ugly. And these kids are, they're crying. Something needed to be done. We had some of the worst laws in the country. So I think we need to look at, one, Education Minnesota is here. They're powerful. Do we have candidates up here who can get some teacher votes? Do we have some candidates up here who can actually do something on education? And I'm in the classroom every single day, and I can tell you there needs to be reforms. But we need to modernize education as well. And by doing that, you have to have some people who understand what these kids are looking for and what is going to work for them. Not people who are lawyers or people who have never taught before. I think that is one of the main things that we need, is we need more teachers and less lawyers and politicians. Thank you.
I think we need students who have every incentive to strive for excellence. Every incentive. And the Common Core actually encourages teaching to the lowest common denominator. We need kids that want to do better than anybody imagined, even their own parents. I support homeschooling, private schooling, parochial schooling as options for parents because every kid may need something different. I am a mom. I have four kids. One graduated from Chaska High School, another one Chaska High School, the other one was Chan High School, and I've got a 10th grader, Sam Ortman. They all started in the Catholic school because I thought that they needed that kind of background in their lives. But every mom, every parent may think that their child needs something different in order to succeed. So we should empower the parents to make those choices. So at the same capital, I've been working on education tax credits so that when parents make the choice to pick an alternative school, that they don't have to pay double taxation to pick what's best for their student. that they can avail themselves of the best educational option that their student needs. And unfortunately, we've had governors that have vetoed education tax credits. My first year in the tax committee introducing that bill, I brought forward a testifier who was a single mom living in Minneapolis with three children, and her oldest child came home with gang markings on her arm, on the arm. And she wanted to move that child to the Catholic school but couldn't get a scholarship because she had too much income, and she earned too much income to avail herself of an education tax credit because she was working. That mom had no choices. Those are the kinds of choices that we need Minnesotans and Americans to be empowered to make sure that our kids strive for excellence again. We shouldn't accept failure from our schools or from our government. We need to make sure that we have a great future, and it begins with education.
All right. Our next round will be the intense and thrilling lightning round.
What happened to our intermission?
Yeah.
But we hit an intermission. So a 10-minute intermission. Please make full use of our bar, get some refreshments, stretch out. We'll be back in 10 minutes.
I'd like to recognize Linda Runbeck. Hello, Linda Runbeck. Raise your hand. And Roger Chamberlain. You say that I'm your favorite radio host?
No, show. Is that show?
Host?
Both of us.
Jack is the best part of all of that. Jack is the best part. Then you can probably find other words.
You take this word.
Thank you, Roger.
Before we get to the lightning round, we do want to ask one question of all our candidates, and that's a short answer. Will you be abiding by the endorsement? You're first.
Will you be abiding by the endorsement, Jim Abeler?
I hope to be endorsed, but I have not pledged to my pledge.
Absolutely, I will honor the endorsement and I will abide by it.
I will abide by the endorsement because I'm trying to earn that trust we talked about at the very beginning. And I don't know how to build trusting relationships between Minnesota communities and our U.S. Senate unless we have strong connections with the community leaders. The leaders who do the vote, the get out the vote calls, the put up the signs, they knock on the doors. I know many of you are here. And so this is our fight. This isn't about one candidate. This is about winning the United States Senate on behalf of Minnesota. And how will our next U.S. Senator know how to vote unless that U.S. Senator has strong connections in the communities all across the state? And this is how we do it, but through our endorsement process. So I will be abiding by the endorsement.
No, I won't. And I'll tell you why. This last election, I challenged the endorsement, as some of you know. I did the best for a challenger in this state since 1946. That's a long time. When you have a small group that decides a big issue, and I love all of you, but sometimes you get the wrong candidate, and we did last time. It was the worst election in almost, the second worst in Minnesota history. I got 20 cents a vote. Ted Cruz gets $3.16 a vote. I got 20 cents a vote. That's how much it cost me to get one vote. It would have been, if I would have won, it would have been the absolute best percentage in the entire U.S. Senate. So I think just because one group of people favors somebody doesn't necessarily mean the rest of the state is going to favor somebody. And again, we're talking about electability. And everyone in here, a lot of you are going to be more conservative than me socially, and I already know it, and you probably already know it. But who can win against Al Franken? And that is a question we have to ask ourselves. Is someone up here, and we got a couple that are missing, but someone up here, one of these candidates is gonna have to be the one to win. Because we want Al gone, right? Well, who is your neighbor gonna vote for? Your neighbor that doesn't really like Al, loves Amy, doesn't really like Al though, but they are willing to vote for a Republican,
all right,
if it's the right Republican.
Thank you.
That's the question.
Move on to Monti, Moreno. Endorsement, yes or no?
Yes.
That's how you answer yes or no
question. All right, we are now to the thrilling lightning round. Questions have been submitted for this evening's forum. I'm explaining that right now.
Do we get flags?
Do you get flags?
Like NFL? Definitely.
Oh, no. You get the... I'll explain the rules.
It's a joke.
No, I get it. Questions have been submitted prior to the forum and at the forum. Because there's so many, we are only going to have 1 minute for each of our candidates to answer these questions, but you will be allowed to rebut. If you raise your hand while the person's asking, get Kelly's attention here. She will make sure that the microphone gets to you, so you'll have a 1 minute rebuttal. You will have the rebuttal only if the answer is different than the response from the first candidate to the question. And then are we only going to allow like one rebuttal? Because this could turn into a rebuttal fest otherwise. Not my same rebuttal. We will begin with Representative Jim Abeler. First lightning round question, 1 minute. How would you address America's current and future energy needs?
Well, I'd start by celebrating the fact that we now import less than half of our oil. I mentioned earlier that we should celebrate that. We need to allow drilling on federal lands. And we need to actually, just in the move into foreign policy, we need to work on our liquefied natural gas and get some terminals going from there, start shipping that to Europe to make Mr. Putin realize we actually mean business, because we can crush him in a couple of years if we can get that part going. We have some of the most amazing reserves of energy in this country if we just use them from here. We need to, I'm on all of the above guy, from clean coal to the nuclear we have, to the gas that we mentioned, and so we can rock this world because we know how to do it. Thank you.
All right, your rebuttal. Next question. Right, Kelly? That's how we're doing it. Right. What is your position on mandatory gun registration, conceal and carry, and high capacity magazines? Mandatory gun registration, conceal and carry, and high capacity magazines.
Well, basically, I'm totally Second Amendment, and the issue is I've been asked about this, any type of further restrictions I'm against. And so I'm a military officer that spent 25 years in the United States Army. I was sworn to defend the Constitution, both foreign and domestic. And the issue is, I talk about this, is that the Second Amendment says the right to bear arms shall not be infringed. There's a period at the end, not a question mark. And so I brought this up, and you know, they say sometimes you've got to talk, you shouldn't be as far as Reagan's 11th commandment talking about other candidates. But I said to Mr. McFadden, I said, I've been troubled on this issue, because he's introduced the idea that there's a problem with gun shows and background checks, and he talks about the gun show loophole. He's wrong there. And so that's a bad path that we're going down. So no more gun restrictions we don't need, and I'm strong on the Second Amendment. Thank you.
Julianne.
Well, I'm proud in this race to have earned the Minnesota Gun Owners PAC endorsement for the United States Senate. And it's because we have a state of one-party rule. Democrats in the House, the Senate, and the governor, and in every other state where they had that, there was actually gun control legislation that was passed in 2013. You know, President Obama and Vice President Biden worked very hard to pass gun control, even here in Minnesota. And we stopped it. We defeated the universal background check in the Minnesota Senate. We worked very hard with a strategy to defeat the Democrat-controlled Senate and House in doing so. And that's why I earned, and I'm very proud of, the gun owner's endorsement in this race.
So as I mentioned earlier, I was a machine gunner on a fixed caliber heavy machine gun in the U.S. Marine Corps. So I do support gun rights, very strong supporter of it. I was endorsed by the NRA in 2008. For the Minnesota State House. I support conceal and carry fully, and I would take this even further. Let's talk about our children in our schools. I would like to put two cops at every single high school and one police officer at, or sheriff at every elementary and junior high. And I think that to have a jewelry store or a jewelry truck have more security than a school with 1,000 of your kids is a travesty, and the fact that none of us are saying anything about it, and our schools are getting shot up by people who, the only way they stop is because their magazine jams, they don't know how to clear it, so they either shoot themselves in the head, or they give themselves up. That's what happens. So having some kind of a deterrent, where people see a squad car, and they know that, hey, there's a cop in there, that's what's gonna happen, and it's a big difference between rural and city. If you're out in the middle of nowhere, it's gonna take a while for someone to get to help you, and that's just the way it is, and that's reality.
Moreno, 1 minute rebuttal.
Oh my gosh. Police officers in our schools? Hell no.
Yeah.
My gosh, what the hell is he thinking? I look at this and think, you know what? If you had people in the schools with guns, people wouldn't be showing up with guns to shoot people. You know, you walk into one of these, you walk into one of these places and you got 50 guns pointing back at you, who's gonna show up? Nobody. The fact of the matter is an unarmed citizenry can be destroyed by their government. We need to stand up and stand against this type of regulation, whether it's Mike McFadden saying the gun show loophole or situations like this saying we need police officers monitoring your kids at school. Pretty soon your entire school will be filled with police officers marching your kids from one classroom to another. Period.
And
no, a double rebuttal?
No double rebuttals. Jim Anker, why
not? Oh, thanks, I'll be brief. I was proudly a supporter when it passed the concealed carry, the right to carry bill. I'm an A-rated NRA and the GOCRA for 16 years now. And absolutely, when I'm sitting at a movie theater and there's a person carrying next to me, I feel safe. So safe. Michael Paymar is like, oh no, there's a gun in the theater. Please, I want to sit by that guy. And finally, gun control. My view of gun control, with two hands, I have much better. Thank you.
We go to Julianne Ortman for the third lightning round question. Lightning round question. What steps would you take to advance conservative principles in Washington?
I had a slight problem with our timekeepers are doing an excellent job, but we didn't clarify that it's 30-second rebuttal.
Oh,
so I know, I'm sorry. Rebuttals are 30 seconds. Thank you.
30-second rebuttals. But you get a minute, Julianne, on the question. Okay. What steps would you take to advance conservative principles in Washington?
Conservative principles. Well, I think we need to work to build a consensus among the Senate Republican caucus in Washington. They're so disjointed, and I don't know what they stand for. So I want them to have an agenda that we can all engage in and make sure that they're working hard to accomplish our goals, like balancing the budget, eliminating the $900 billion budget gap. Who would disagree with that? And if you're going to do that, who would disagree with the idea that maybe we need to have workforce reduction from all those non-essential employees that were furloughed? Or to make sure that we budget in a two-year cycle. These are the types of agenda items that we can all agree on. For instance, another budget solution would be to eliminate use it or lose it budgeting, where agencies are given an incentive to spend every dime that they are budgeted, otherwise they get a penalty. That's common sense. So we need to bring an agenda forward through the Senate Republican caucus to empower them to have far more leverage and influence over our nation's agenda. We need fiscal conservative leaders, and we need someone who will work hard behind the scenes to get everybody together to be a stronger voice.
Jimmy, a little rebuttal. 30 seconds.
Well, thank you. It's, in 30 seconds, you can't do a lot, but you want to actually go from what you wish you could do to what you can do to what you know how to do. In Minnesota, I have actually done it by reducing spending, by changing how we do our human service programs, by making a difference in education. And so when you're doing any kind of this work, you want to begin with the end in mind. I grieved when I watched the shutdown, how badly they ran their work there. And so you actually know where you're going. And so I'm going to run out of time. Thank you.
Chris Dahlberg, you've got 30 seconds.
Thank you. This is a real easy one. The way we do it is you do it right here. And so you're looking and you're vetting us right now. And I see that there are people out here taking notes. I think that's fantastic. So you pick the strongest conservative, and don't buy into the fact that we need a rhino to run in this race to beat out Franken. We don't. We can have a strong constitutional conservative. So here's where you go and compare my record and compare myself to other people. So when you start to have people saying, I'm for the Second Amendment, but I'm trouble with the gun show loophole, run from that candidate. Yeah. When you have a candidate that says, I'm trouble with NSA spying, but by the way, it's okay in Hennepin County, that's troubling. Thank you.
David Carlson, I believe you're next, if my math is correct. How will you work to keep your term transparent and focused on doing what's right for Minnesota rather than offering preferences to large campaign donors and lobbyists? 1 minute.
Well, first of all, I've raised less than anyone up here. Some of these guys have billionaires funding their campaigns. Some of them have PACs that are dropping tens of thousands. They'll be dropping more. I think everyone in here pretty much knows that I took orders for 4 years in the infantry, and I've not taken orders from any party. I don't take orders from any party boss. I'm gonna do what I think is right, because at the end of the day, my daughters are gonna look at me and they're not gonna say, my dad was a sellout. That's just not who I am. And that's not where I come from. And a lot of people are. And you know what? They're bought and paid for. And you can see it from the lobbyists. And you can see it in all your senators. So if you think everyone up here is all of a sudden gonna be the magic horse that's not going to take orders, then maybe that's the person you should go for. If not, I'll tell you right now, I'm not.
All right, we'll move on to our fifth question. Monti Moreno, what is your view on entitlement spending like Social Security and Medicare, and what is your solution to keeping them from bankrupting our nation? 1 minute. If you can fit it over.
Really? Social Security, Medicare, why don't we deal with something a little bit more substantive? Social Security, as I addressed earlier, is we do not have enough citizens to pay for the retiring beneficiaries. So the simple solution is, let's open the border, bring over the illegals to turn them into citizens so they start paying taxes. That's been the solution in the past. We have some real issues there. You know, when it comes to, I'm gonna jump into Obamacare, because Obamacare has created an absolute nightmare for us, whether you recognize it or not. But what you need to do is delete Obamacare, get rid of it. And when you do, open up states' rights to where each state can compete from state to state, driving down the cost, no different than your cell phone bill. The more competition, the lower your price goes down, the better service you get, period.
Well, 30 seconds.
There's 30 seconds.
Areas of entitlement.
30 seconds, Jim.
How long do I get?
30 seconds.
Go ahead.
30 seconds.
No. You gotta get 25 seconds.
30 seconds is up.
There's three main things people call entitlements: Medicaid, Medicare, and Social Security. Medicare and Social Security are not entitlements. They've been paid in by people. We owe them. Medicaid, we balanced in Minnesota and managed it. Medicare can be managed the same way. At this point, New York, Florida, Texas, and California are just backing up the truck, and we need to manage that. And
you take 15 more seconds.
Okay, you're sweet, thanks. And so there's a way to get more quality out of less money in Medicare by doing things like Minnesota does. We are a leader. That's what I know how to do. That's what I want to do in Washington. Social Security, people have paid in, they're actually entitled to what they've got.
All right, thank you. And you're next. Oh, Julianne, we're about 30 seconds.
We have a Social Security trust fund. We need to make sure that Congress doesn't borrow and spend that money. If we did that, we would actually be able to fund Social Security. And so we have a Congress that is running these programs into bankruptcy. It's time to insert those constitutional or the conservative principles and make sure that we don't touch those funds again and restore those funds.
Jim, you are you're next we're with you again. Next question: how would you protect states' rights for Minnesota? 1 minute.
Well, first you have to remember that actually they deserve them. It's there's constitutional duties and separation of powers, which the president seems to have forgotten. He undoes any law that he likes. Education and health care belong to the states, and glaring examples are the Obamacare, Common Core, etc. And so the federal government's job is to like keep us safe, do currency, handle interstate commerce, and like that. And so it's been an ever-steady encroachment by a bipartisan basis of things that the feds like to do. Spending more and more money on ridiculous projects that you would never pick to do as you had a triage of kind of spending that we do. And so you actually want to work yourself out of a job to an extent you become a U.S. senator and say, no, that's not our job. Minnesota, you take care of education. Minnesota, you take care of your health care. Minnesota, you take care of the needs of your citizens inside your state. And so you start by deciding that's where you want to go. A dozen or 50 steps to implement that, you have to unwind it all. But you want to know where you're going, and it can be done. We can do it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Rebuttal is that I have a lot more focus than Al Franken has, and that's the problem. I mean, I talked earlier. The role of the federal government is national defense, protection of the citizenry, both here and abroad, protection of our borders. But you have him involved in everything under the sun. I mean, he's involved in free cheese sandwiches for the kids, new programs, you could say, all the time. And that's the thing. You have to have the discipline to go to Washington. Just because you have the power to do something doesn't mean you should do it. And you have to have the discipline to say, this is the state's job, they should be doing it.
A party to the lawsuit on Obamacare that went all the way to the United States Supreme Court, because I believe that Obamacare was an invasion of our state's rights. And the Chief Justice, in his order, said that when a state actually signs on to a program and they commit to all of the requirements of that program, that has to change in Congress. The carrot and stick program has to be done. So think about all the highway funding, for instance. We get highway funding from the federal government, and what comes along with that are the requirements to adopt primary seatbelt laws and 55 miles per hour, all those requirements. And so we have a lot of work to do to make sure Congress doesn't impose on our rights in that way.
Electability. Again, if we put up a candidate that's far more conservative than the average Minnesota voter, we will have another 6 years of Al Franken, and we're going to lose more states' rights, and there's going to be more federal issues that are going to be taking over, and you're going to have more presidential vetoes, you're going to have more nominees to the Supreme Court that are going to not be where you want, and you have to look who's electable, who can beat Al Franken, who's going to get new votes. We don't have enough votes. How many Republicans are in office? How many? Not a whole lot. And there's a reason why. We keep putting up candidates who aren't electable. That's the bottom line. Who do we have running for the Senate that can beat Al? That's the main question that is going to be asked to the state.
And my name Moreno, 30 seconds.
Well, I don't know about that. I guess last time they ran a right-wing conservative and he won, what, 49 states, wasn't it? Ronald Reagan? You know, a conservative will lead. And as you lead, people will follow. And it's all about leadership, ladies and gentlemen. And, you know, I'm not talking about getting in the back of the bus or being on the short bus, and nothing implied from the standpoint of everybody's intelligence. But when you start looking at what Washington's doing right now, you need leadership, and I'm the leader that will lead the entire U.S. Senate, starting with the impeachment of Barack Hussein Obama. Thank you.
We're going to Chris Dahlberg.
One state did vote for George Bush. That was Minnesota. Voted Dukakis. Very important.
What is your Chris Dahlberg? What is your position on increasing the minimum wage? 1 minute.
I was asked that before by Rachel Stassen-Bergen on this, and I think the federal government has no role in the minimum wage, so they shouldn't be involved in it. I think I distinguished myself, Senator Ortman, I think, voted against the minimum wage increase for the state, but indexing it to the federal government. I disagree. We shouldn't be tying it all to the federal government. It's a state decision to make, but I think it's a bad decision when they're increasing it. The evidence shows that it bars the very people that need to get into the job entry, those people that might have been suffering from chemical abuse, that chemical dependency, that are trying to get back in. People maybe that have some criminal background issues that are trying to get back in the job market, young people. So, but it's a state issue. When she asked me, well, what happens if all the states decide to have these different policies? Well, you know what starts to happen? It's the free market takes a role, and then they have a reversal in the elected officials, because when they make bonehead decisions and start increasing it, which kills jobs, all of a sudden they get recalled from office because they realize our economy is going down the tube. Thank you.
Rebuttals? 30 seconds.
Well, the Democrats in St. Paul passed a $9.50 minimum wage increase indexed to inflation. There's no way our economy here in Minnesota can weather that kind of an increase, because what that means is going to be lost jobs and fewer hours for people that want to work and support themselves. And so there is a federal government minimum wage at $7.25 an hour. Federal government President Obama wants $10.10 an hour. That's what's being considered in Washington. I absolutely oppose that. I oppose the $9.50 increase.
Well, the problem is not the minimum wage, ladies and gentlemen. What it is America's monetary policy. When I was a kid, you'd go to the store and you'd get three pieces of licorice for one penny. Today, you buy one piece of licorice, it's 25 cents. You'd buy a loaf of bread for 10 cents, today that same loaf of bread is $4. We have a fiat currency where our government is overspending money, and they are spending the money to the tune of $85 billion a month, and every dollar they print is making the money in your pocket worth less. It's called inflation, it's a backhanded form of taxation, and that is eating away at the American family. You go ahead and you do away with the fiat currency, and you all of a sudden will have people with money that matters. Thank you.
You know, you mentioned 49 states voted Reagan. What state didn't vote? What state voted for Michael Dukakis? It wasn't his home state, Minnesota. That's the state we're in. So that's a question you need to ask yourself, is what kind of state are we in?
Can I relate to this question?
No.
No. About increasing the minimum wage? Okay. We are out of time, so we are going to move. Oh, you got to move up in 30 seconds.
This came up on the floor. All the Republicans voted no. And the debate, I just thought I'd share with you, was amazing. The Democrats had the idea that money falls out of the sky, or that some evil three-person business owned by a family is somehow hanging on to the money. They're bragging. The governor bragged last night about $500 million is going to flow into all these people at minimum wage, falling from the sky. Anyway, which is madness. We spent time on the floor. I told about our company that's going to go out of business. One of my local Latino friends has a restaurant. He's going to lose one of the three restaurants because of this. And they didn't even care. Really? Thanks.
All right, we're going to move on to closing statements so we can finish as close to 9 o'clock as possible. There are 3-minute closing statements. That's what I have in the rules here. You can use less if you wish. 3-minute closing statements. Please, in your closing statements, tell us why you want to represent the state of Minnesota as senator in Washington, D.C. We begin with Monti Moreno.
Well, thank you for this evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for the meeting that we've had here tonight, the ability for us to be together. As your next U.S. Senator going to Washington, I will not back down, period. As I said earlier, I was a boxer. I fought some of the biggest, meanest, ugliest looking dudes you've ever seen. And they typically ended up on the floor, all right? Now, the same thing's gonna happen to Al Franken. I will not back down. But I will lead. When you look at people like Lois Lerner, who's going against and using the IRS as a club to beat conservative groups, I will move to put this woman in jail because that's exactly where she deserves to be. When I look at a man named Eric Holder, that man needs to be held in contempt of Congress and he needs to go to jail. Amen. These people, Barack Hussein Obama, he said he was gonna have the most transparent administration we've ever seen. I don't know about you, ladies and gentlemen, but it looks pretty opaque. I can't see anything. When you look at Benghazi, my gosh, these people are covering up the lies with more lies, and they're tripping over their own lies. It's absolutely disgusting. When I look at the U.S. Senate, let's get back to this for a moment. When you look at the two most prominent U.S. senators in the United States of America, who are they? I would contend with you that it's Marco Rubio and Ted Cruz. Now, why isn't it Rubio, Cruz, and Moreno, the three amigos? Right? Yeah. What we're looking at here is we understand that we have 12 to 14 million illegal immigrants in America, and we need to bring them to the Republican Party so we remain the majority and we do not remain the minority. As I said earlier, if you like the way things are being run right now, coming, flowing down on us, from St. Paul and Washington, just keep doing the same thing, ignore these people. That 7% difference of this Latino vote will make the difference of us being the majority versus us being the minority. I have children, I have grandchildren, I know you do too. For the future of our country, I don't want to be the minority here for the next 20 years, and I know you don't either. We have one chance with this motor voter law that this governor put upon us this last year. Now, either we take this control of this or we lose for a long, long time. I don't want to be that minority. I also am a strong supporter of Israel, and I believe America needs to have Israel's back. When I'm looking at places like Crimea, I believe it's absolutely American military weakness, not the weakness in the military, but the leadership. Again, Barack Hussein Obama, who's emboldened our enemies. And I want to let you know that, again, with Monti Moreno as your U.S. Senator, our foreign enemies will fear us, and our enemies here in America will hate us, because we're going to take it over. Thank you so much, my name is Monti Moreno.
Thank you. I want to be your next U.S. Senator because I care, and things are broken. The average age of a Minnesotan is 37. The average age of an American is 37. 55% of the United States Americans are under 42 years old. We have a Senate where there has not been a senator born after 1973. That's a problem. The other day, Monti Moreno was asked the same question, and his answer was, because I'm the only one of true, authentic Hebrew blood. That's not gonna work. You're not gonna be getting crossover votes. And that is what is gonna be needed to win this election. My background, I'm surrounded right now by lawyers and a hairdresser. I'm a teacher, I'm a Marine. I'm not a lawyer in the Marines. I was an infantry machine gun. I put my life on the line, and I've lost friends in this war because I care. And because I am not someone who just talks the talk. If I went to Washington, you can bet there's going to be stuff getting done. What I tell you I'm going to do, I'm going to try to do. When someone's going against Al Franken, he's a bully. Everyone saw it. Everyone saw it with Coleman. How are you going to beat a bully? Well, you got to have someone who can be just as tough as him, but can actually get new votes. I'm the only one up here who supported marriage equality. The majority of Minnesota voters also supported marriage equality. You might not, but it's the law, and that is not going anywhere. How are we going to win this election? We're going to win this election by putting someone up who new Minnesota voters will vote for. And I don't think they want another lawyer. They don't want another millionaire. They don't want Mike McFadden. He's not here, but we talk about minimum wage. The average Minnesotan would like to see more money and people at the bottom of his pocket. Well, I'll give an example from up in the Iron Range. Mike McFadden had a company that they consulted on, $250,000 a month he was consulting on, and they got an $11 million bonus. That is what people think of Republicans. Is that all Republicans? Most Republicans are hardworking middle-class Americans. But what is the average typical Republican that people see run? They see multimillionaire, they see out of touch, they see unelectable. And that's a problem. That's why we keep losing these races. And we have to take a serious look at, one, how are we going to defeat Al Franken? Because the Senate could be flipped. And President Obama could have to change his entire agenda. We need someone who understands security. I've done security. I've done security for the Commanding General, 1st Marine Division, 1st Marine Expeditionary Force. I have a background in security. I have a master's in security. I'm in Texas A&M University studying security, studying intelligence. Intelligence is big. Everyone talks about it. U.S. border security, we've talked about that. Those are areas we actually need senators who don't just get talking points and don't get told, this is what you think, we're going to lock you up for the next 4 months and quiz you until you're good enough to debate. We need someone who actually understands these issues and understands policies. And I've done the work, and I would do the work against Al Franken. We need someone who has the energy, someone who has the drive, and someone who's electable. And I think I'm the most electable person. And I think I'm the one who can win, and I'll work the hardest. And you can take that home. I guarantee it.
Thank you.
Well, I'm a mom from Chanhassen. And I'm a public servant. You know, we live in the greatest nation in the world, and we have an amazing constitution that will supply all the answers and the roadmap to addressing the problems we face as a nation today. The $17 trillion national debt, the budget gap, the NSA spying, the war on our gun rights. The answers are in the Constitution, and the answer is a stronger United States Senate. A United States Senate that is not afraid to assert the Constitution protections that protect each of us. A U.S. Senate that is not afraid to deny confirmation to judges that sit in secret chambers in the U.S. Capitol building, granting orders to spy on U.S. citizens, innocent U.S. citizens. We need U.S. senators that are brave enough to do the work that they are authorized to do under the United States Constitution. And when we have that, we will have constitutional order again. And so just a little bit about my background. I live with my husband, Ray. We've been married for almost 25 years. It works because he's always right and I know everything. I'm a negotiator. I have four kids. They are 23, 22, 19, and 16. Yes, they are all taller than me. And Raymond Ortman is private first class Raymond Ortman. He serves in our United States Army, and I'm so proud of him. And I'm so proud of the men and women that serve our nation. They deserve a Congress, a Commander-in-Chief, and a Secretary of State that understand and recognize the dedication that they've offered us, what it truly means to be citizens. They each are truly, fully citizens of the United States of America. We deserve a nation that is respected again, an America that is respected in the world. When we speak, our words should mean something again. And so I want to remind you all, the answers to the problems that we face in Washington, we have it in our pocket, most of us, it's in our Constitution. Don't give up, don't be discouraged, don't distrust anymore, instead, be committed. Be determined to use the power of citizenship to its fullest. Use it in this election. Let's remove Al Franken from office. And then let's not just elect somebody. Let's elect somebody who will make a difference, who will insist
on that constitutional order again, a nation that we can be proud of. We can do it. We don't have to give up. We have far more power and are far more influential than the special interests and the Washington insiders ever dreamed. Let's use that power on November 4th, 2014. And let's not give Al Franken a 3-month head start. Let's select our best candidate on May 30th at the convention in Rochester, and let's put her to work.
Thank you. My name again is Chris Dahlberg. I'm from up in Duluth, and I'm working for the endorsement, and I am going to abide by the endorsement. And thanks again to 38A and 38B for hosting this. A lot of work, and this was just a great event. Thanks to all of you who came here. I mean, just tremendous that you took the time as citizens to come here, taking notes, being engaged. And to all my fellow candidates, we've enjoyed having fun out on the road. It's been a great time. I want to invite you to my website. It's dahlbergnow.com. Again, it's www.dahlbergnow.com. You know, we're here as a family discussion about who's the best candidate. And don't buy into the issue again that we need to have a purple candidate. We can have a solid candidate that's a conservative in this. And I've talked about being a constitutional conservative. But let me tell you, this is the right message that can win Minnesota. Because I know what I'm speaking of, in that I come from northeastern Minnesota. And yes, they do vote Democrats, but I'll tell you what, these are Reagan Democrats up there, and they're more conservative than a lot of Republicans. And so they believe in the Second Amendment. They're pro-life. They're hard workers. They've worked all their life, and they're starting to look around at this nation going, what's going on? Too many people are riding on the cart. Not enough people are willing to pull the wagon. And they get it. And so you'll check my record out. I'm a solid conservative, but I'm the most electable in this race. Twice I've been at the top of the polling for the Republican Party. Recently, former Congressman Chip Cravath last Monday endorsed me. Now maybe people remember Chip Cravath. He took on a guy that said couldn't be beat, Jim Oberstar. I think he had 32, 34 years. And endorsing me, Congressman Cravath said this. He said, I know a little bit about being an underdog in a race. Well, I get it. We're gonna be all in underdogs up against Al Franken with what he's got and the power that comes. But you know what? It's about the message. It's about the messenger. And so we can do this. One of the things I've been successful in northeastern Minnesota is getting those Reagan Democrats. Check out my table over here. One of the things, I have a flyer, and I think it's very illustrative about what's going on. Norm Coleman lost my county, St. Louis County, by 22 percentage points. 22 percentage points. Now, everybody up here is fine Republicans. Every one of us can win in the Republican suburbs around Minneapolis and St. Paul. But we don't win this race by only having Republicans. We have to have independents, and we have to have those Reagan Democrats. I've demonstrated up in northeastern Minnesota that I can get the Reagan Democrats. I talked about being a Finlander Swede. Well, my great-grandfather actually founded Cherry, Minnesota. The Building and Trades Construction Union guys and gals actually endorsed me in my county commissioner race, because they know Dahlberg gets it. He knows timber, taconite, and tourism on the Iron Range. Finally, I'm going to leave you with this. You know, it's gotten to be for the race for the United States Senate. There's four important qualities you have to have when you're running for the United States Senate nowadays. What is it? Tall, dark, handsome, and a millionaire. I'm none of these, but people who know me up there knows one thing. Chris Dahlberg's not a show horse. He's a workhorse. You endorse me at that state convention, I'm going to take it to Al Franken. I'm going to get northeastern Minnesota on our side. I'm going to get the Republican suburbs down here. We're going to win the independent votes and the Reagan Democrats. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you like to hear the question again?
Thank you. You've been an awesome audience. I've been watching you. You pay great attention. Without the workers like you, we would not have a party. We would have no chance to even get anything resembling Minnesota back on track and America back on track. Yeah, we've talked about healthcare, where I'm known to be an expert. I have 35 years in practice. I know what needs to get done to get Minnesota the leader that it needs to be. On the deficit, which is going to eat our lunch, where no Republican in the country has any talent about going after that entitlement part, the Medicaid part, the food stamps, all that. That's where I've got my expertise. That's what I did in Minnesota. We cut $1 billion a year in 2011 under my oversight. The largest spending cut in Minnesota history, worth $1 trillion if you extrapolate that with Minnesota quality over a decade. No one else knows how to do that. Those are the topics of our time. And so you can look at my record. There's three E's I want to remind you about, though, as you look over this whole election, and you have a choice to make. Economics, electability, and effectiveness. I'll remind you, Norm Coleman spent $19 million to lose. We cannot buy this seat. You can do it by going Main Street to Main Street, town to town, touching lives where you can, as I have done. This is my 345th stop since August, more than all the rest of the candidates, maybe even combined. And so, who are they looking for to have be their senator? Somebody who understands it. I fix my own roofs, I paint walls, I'm a chiropractor, but I know it is a blue-collar town. Those of you who have the bio card about me, look at the other side about the work I've done, groups that have recognized my abilities and my product over 16 years. Disability groups, small business groups, people in the healthcare industry, people who represent a lot of voters, people who know that I know how to get something done in a respectful way, in a polite way. And finally, effectiveness. Everybody here wants to get stuff done. Everybody who's won and gone there has wanted to get stuff done. Most have failed. There's reality and there's rhetoric. I know how to actually work with groups to get things done as a minority. There have never been three Republicans in my world. There's always been a Democratic governor, or in this case, all three Democrats. I still got stuff done by virtue of how I work. And that's what people want. And so we're gonna reach out to I've spent a lot of time in the 4th and 5th district, which is where we have to bring the needle up. I'm the kind of person they would vote for. And so at the end, you have a choice to make. I hope to have earned your support, and I hope to have earned your support by the time the convention comes and beyond that. Our website's jimabeler.com. Look us up, you'll get to see a picture of Raina on there and the rest of my family, some of the things we've worked on. It does make a difference in Washington who goes. I can make a difference. You know, God has been so gracious to this country, and not always deservedly so. But I pray he continues to bless this awesome BPOU 38A&B, and he continues to bless this great country of ours. Thank you, Brandon.
Thank you. Let's thank all of the candidates for coming tonight. Thank you for having me on the house. We just talked about our life. Thank you, BPOU. And thank you to the timekeepers.
Time keepers.
Game 11:30, 6 to 9, Monti, Tuesday.